47 Linux commands that you need to know. I'm going to demo each command, show the key options and flags. Let's get going. Okay, to start with ls, this is how I'm going to list all the files in our directory. We'll use the L flag for more details and the A flag to show hidden directories and files. Clear, we wipe our screen to make it fresh. I love this command, I use it all the time. Change directories with cd, so I'm going to change to folder 1. I can go to folder 1 with cd. When I go back up a level, I use dot dot. When I know where I am, I use pwd to print the working directory. This is how I can figure out where I am if I'm in a deep nested directory structure. When I make a directory, I use the mkdir command. I want to make a new directory with nested subfolders, I can use the p flag. If I want to create new folder, that does that. If I have a look, see new folder is there. If I change to new folder, I have a look inside and see the subfolder is also there. If I want to delete files, I use the rm command. If I want to delete directories, I need to use the r flag for recursively deleting things. If I want to remove folder tree, I need to do this. If I want to remove the new folder that I just created, I could do this. Now I'll remove everything there. If I use ls, I can see the new folder is no longer with us. If I want to copy files and directories, I use the cp command. If I want to copy directories, I need to use the r flag for recursively doing it. Let's copy folder 1 over to folder 1 backup with this command. We have a look inside. This is what we see. We have a look inside folder 1 backup. We see it, the same thing is copied out. If I want to move files or rename them, and this is the same thing in Linux, you're just changing file path, I use the mv command. If I want to rename file 1, I can rename it to renamed file1.txt, and that has now changed this. I can see it is now called renamed file1. This works because you're just changing the path. So renaming and moving are the same thing in Linux. Create new files, simply use touch. Okay, an empty file, simple as that. If I want to view a file, I use the cat command. If I want to view what's inside it, I can use file1.txt. Let's have a look inside what we've got. So let's have a look at view file. Cat, we're going to view file, and this shows the internal content of that. Now, if I want to add to this file, I can also use cat, because cat not only views files, it can overwrite or append. If I want to overwrite, I can send the contents of one file to another. So if, for instance, I use this command, I'm using cat to send the contents of view file to a new file called newfile.txt. If this file already existed, I would be overwriting everything in there. If I run that right now, if I then look at the contents of the new file, that's what you see. If I run this again, but instead of using that, how about we use an echo command? So with an echo command, which I'll cover next, you can send text to a file to the tone. So here, what I am doing is that echoing this content to a new file, but I'm using two carrots here, which says append my overwrite. If I run this, output you'll see is now added. However, if I want to overwrite the file, I can simply delete one of these, run the command again, view the contents, and there we go, I have overwritten. Speaking of editing text, nano is the way to go if you want to have a simple text editor to make edits within terminal. So I could do this, write out with control O, hex it with control X. If I then look at the contents of this file, they can go, there are my edits. We've already covered echo. Echo is how we can send text to the terminal or to other files. So for instance, if I wanted to use this command, I would be able to echo this string within these quotes to the new file.txt. If I did that, then printed the output, you would see it now says, hello Linux, we've overwritten it. Notice again, one caret means overwriting, but I've done two carets, it would have appended. If I want to search the files, use the find command. If I want to search the files within Linux demo, I could then use this and search with a wild path for all text files within here, and it lists all text files in folders and subfolders. Another great way to search is to search within files using grep. This is one of the most famous commands in Linux. We use grep all the time. This is searching text within files, and you can use the I flag to make it case insensitive. Here, let's look within the fruits.txt file for anything with the word apple, and then we go to two instances of apple. It's found those and highlighted them for us. And the really helpful command in NS is chmod, and this is how we change file permissions. A common thing to do is to use chmod 755. Not familiar with permissions, this is setting the bits on read, write, and execute. And 755 means we give all permissions to the user and the group, and the others get 55. So they don't get all permissions. So if you're not sure how permissions work, if you want to read up on this, I'd encourage looking up using binary for setting the bit for setting the permissions within Linux. And this is a very simple way to do this. So chmod 755 changes my script to have those permissions. And if I look at this, I can see my script in green over here, and I can see the permissions there is read, write, and execute, which is what we want for the user because he's got a 7. Fantastic, that works. Another common command, a bit like chmod, is chown or chown or chown, whatever you want to call it, is to change the ownership of the file. With this, you can change the ownership of a certain file to another user. So if I were to run this command, now within this command, I'm using sudo, which I will cover in a moment. If the admin privileges, I'm using the chown command change the ownership of myscript.sh to new user. I run this, it will ask for my QPU user password. I enter this in, notice that it's hidden. It will then change the ownership of that file to that person. Fantastic. Now we mentioned sudo. Sudo is a command that you use all the time in Linux. This gives you admin privileges and you have to enter your password after you enter it. Although if you run many sudo commands in a row, you'd only have to enter your password once. Now, another command we use is apt. This is to install packages with Debian. If you're on Fedora, you might be using yum. That's fine. But we use apt to install, remove or update packages or software. So I could use sudo apt install and I'll install this package. It would then get it and fetch it. And notice I don't have to enter my password, so I enter my sudo password and then to go. Now, how do we know how much free disk space we've got? Simple, we use df, we use hflag for it to be human readable. Similarly, if you want to know how much space is being used by a directory or a file, we can use the du command. And in this case, we will use this command and we use s to make it human readable. Look at the large file and it is using 11 megabytes. If you want to monitor system processes, a bit like task manager windows, you use top. It will show you everything that's running and how many resources it's using. And exit, you use kube. Again, clear B. If you want to list all running processes in the system and then apply filtering, you can use ps and then you can use aux and then with piping to grep with your filter term. So here I'm filtering for nano. And here you see I have two nano processes. Next, if I want to delete or kill, because we kill processes, I can kill them all if they are related to nano, and I can use this command. I'm using sudo with kill all and anything related to nano, this will kill all its processes. If I run my grep command again, you'll see it is now gone. That nano process has been removed. So killing processes is a key part of being an admin, and kill all is a great way to do that if you want everything in a certain instance to be deleted. And to know how much RAM you've got available, free is the command, and h could you human readable, and you can see how much RAM is available, used, and free. Want to know how long the system's been running? Uptime. Now the sysadmin, 35 days for me. Also, if you're on a system with multiple users, how do you know which one you logged in as? Who am I will tell you who you are logged in as, and I am Robert in this instance. How about figuring out commands you've used before and you want to go back through? You can use history to see all the commands you've previously run, and you can scan back through this, really helpful. The great command is man. With man, you can look at manual pages for any other command. This is like help documentation for any Linux command. Learn while using the terminal. Here it is for ls. Q will get you out of that screen. How about fetching files from the web? Well, you can use wget to download files. In this case, I've used the o flag to specify the output file name, and here I'm downloading a file from the internet and saving it to my own directory called 10 megabits.zip. Here we go, it downloads that file. I then use ls, you can see the file is there. Similarly, you can transfer data using curl, another really popular way to transfer data programmatically at command line. Here, I'm going to fetch something from a JSON placeholder website and see the output as JSON. You can use this all the time for fetching data from APIs. Now, how about we want to use something to sync all of our files between directories? If you've ever used S3 and AWS, you might have used sync to sync files from a remote bucket to your local machine. Here, you can sync your files from one folder to another folder. In this case, I'm going to sync them to a folder called backup. So in this case, I will take this command and I simply say, take everything in my Linux demo, I need to sync it to backup. And there we go. And it has now synced everything to a backup folder. This is a great way to backup really quickly. Now, how about making secure copies? If you're ever wanting to securely copy between remote systems, you'll be using SSH or SCP. Let's start with SSH. With SSH, you can log into a remote system, whether that's on the cloud or wherever it may be. Simply use SSH. You would use PI to indicate where your key is for access to the system. And then you would enter the name of the system that you are going to. So in this instance, I'm just going to connect to localhost. And here you go, I'm now inside the localhost. Notice the Linux demo directory has disappeared, so I'm now inside a different machine. To exit, I simply use exit, and you can see I logged out. SCP is very similar. In SCP, you might want to copy, for instance, a file from your system to a remote system or vice versa. And you can do this using SSH, but the SCP command is what you need. And again, to log in with your credentials, so I would use my credentials. I've got my SCP command, iFlag for credentials. Then if I want to copy, for instance, file.txt, so we should have file one, I assume. Let's just quickly list what we've got here. So we've got file two. So SCP, we're going to use that. We're going to go file two. And we're going to copy that to the localhost. And then maybe just specify where we want to send it. And that will then copy that file over to the localhost or whatever remote host you're connected to. Now, how about creating links? LN create links, whether they're hard or symbolic links. You use an S for symbolic link. You can essentially reference a file in multiple places. It's the same file, but you're referencing it in different places within the link. So if I were to use this command here, I can create a symlink from my viewfile.txt to another file called symlink to viewfile. I then use my ls, you will see the symlink is there. If I cat the symlink, the output shows this. And if I cat the viewfile, the output is that. If I then want to edit the viewfile, if I go to nano and then edit this, and then delete this output. And then if I cat it again, you'll see it's gone. And if I cat the symlink, what do you see? The same content. They are the same file. It's just a reference to that file. Symlink are massively helpful in Linux. So get familiar with the ln command. If you want to view the first lines of a file, you can use the head command with an n flag to specify how many lines you want to see, as if the five lines at the top of the fruits file. If you ever use pandas and data science, you'll be familiar with head and looking at the top row of the data frame. This is the same principle. Tail is the opposite of head. This looks at the last lines. For instance, let's look at the last lines of this. And if we add the F flag, we can finish changes in real time. This leaves you locked in. So if you are looking at a file like a log file and it's updating in real time, this will keep printing them to the screen as they come. If we want to leave this, we can just Control C and get at. Now, another great command that we can use is the diff command to compare two files line by line and show the differences. If we have a look in here, we have got file 2. What if we copy file 2, the .txt, and call it file2p.fa, then let's nano file2.txt, let's add this. This is a file, and then we're going to output this, and then exit. Then let's nano file.txt, and let's set this is another file, output, and exit. Now we're going to run the diff command. This is going to compare file2.txt, and we're then going to compare this to file2a.txt. And what we're looking to see is the differences. And here you can see it is highlighting the differences. So this is really helpful if you want to see the differences line by line within different files. And it's shown on the first line, they are different. There are multiple lines, you'll see more differences if they were that. Now let's use the sort command. This sorts the contents of a file alphabetically, and we can use the R flag for reverse sorting if you wanted. So let's sort our fruits. And here we go, they are now sorted in alphabetical order. If I want to use the R flag, let's do it in reverse, and there you see they are in reverse. Also, we can use WC for the word count. This will give us the word count, and then you see there are five words within this. And you can also add flags L, W, or Z for specific accounts. Now let's talk about alias. Alias is a great way to create a shortcut for a common use command. For instance, if you're using LS, L, LS, LA, which a lot of us do, you could say, I want to use alias. I'm going to create the alias LL, and I'm going to say, this is LS, LA. Save this. And now you can just run LL, and it will do that for you. This is a really common alias, and it's a great way if you've got very complicated pipe together commands, whatever you're using to create aliases, so you don't have to remember them all and just do it all for you. Shortcuts are amazing. Now, tar. Tar is how we can create or extract archives. You can use the CZF flag to create and the XZF flags to extract. So for instance, if I wanted to create a compressed archive, I could use the tar with a CZF flag to basically create that out of an existing file. So for instance, if I wanted to use tar and print it, I'd do the CZF. Let's say I've got file2.tar.bz. And this is coming from file2.txt. I create that. If I have a look, I should now see I've got my file2.tar.gz. If I wanted to extract that, I would just change it from CZF to XZF. Speaking of compression, another great option is to use a gzip. Gzip will compress individual files, and you can use gunzip or gunzip to decompress them. So if I wanted to use gzip on file2a.txt, it would create that. If I have a look, I've now got file2a.txt.gz, and then I can use gunzip to unzip that, and then have another look. You can see it is now back. The gz file is gone, and it has been replaced with the txt file. So gzip and gunzip or gunzip are great ways to compress files quickly in Linux, a bit like using winzip if you're used to Windows back in the day. Now let's have a look at the sed or sed command, which is the stream editor for text manipulation. Basically, you can perform text substitution in files, use it to find and replace text. If you look at this command, I'm going to replace all instances of hello with hi in dfile.txt, and now it outputs the new file and says, hi, this is a test file, as opposed to hello, this is a test file. Now let's talk about awk or all. This is a text processing tool, and they use the pattern scanning and text processing, so you can extract specific fields from text files. So in this case, I'm going to extract the first column of the fruits.txt file. So if I use this command, that is the first column. This works because if you have a look at the fruits.txt file, all the words are in columns. There is one column. If instead this was a sentence and it was multiple words in a sentence, the first column would be the first word on that line, if that makes sense, and so on and so forth. Now let's talk about cron tab. Cron is how you can schedule recurring tasks. I'm using cron tab with the E flag, we can edit cron jobs. So let's create a very simple cron job to run every minute, appending hello to the cronlog.txt file. Simply run this, and with those things, it is now looking for the command I found. That's slightly unusual, obviously, because the file isn't there. That's fine. But in general, you use this, and you've got these wildcards, which will fkib hello to this file. So if you have a look in here, you can see cronlog.txt. If we have a look at cronlog.txt, that will be fkibbing on a minute-by-minute basis, so we'd have to wait that update. Now, let's finish off with something fun. I think it's fun to look at some Linux lore and to look at some silly commands that exist that you wouldn't know were there. So this is maybe less than an essential command, but maybe something fun that you can show some friends with in Linux. Rather than typing ls, sometimes people accidentally write sl, and when you do that, this is what you get. A train going across the screen. Then there's bizarre command of all. It's just a bit of fun. It's the Linux developers making things fun to say, if you get it wrong, here's an Easter egg for you. You've also got an additional Easter egg here. If you use the L flag, you get an extra long train. So SL, instead of one carriage, is now towing two carriages. So there we go. That is the last Linux command. Maybe the other 46 are more essential. This is just something fun so that you can show friends and show other people that Linux is actually a humorous OS. And there you go. That completes it. That is 47 essential Linux commands that you need to know and to get you going and get you really comfortable at command line. This has been a rapid fire, but hopefully it's a great reference that you can look at to learn how to use Linux command line effectively. Remember, most of these commands can be piped together. Commands can be linked together into more complicated commands, allowing you to do really powerful things at the command line. When you get comfortable with it, I think you'll find there is no going back. Hope you have fun. Thanks for watching. If there's anything you'd like to comment, as always, let me know. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I can't wait to see you in the next one.